you very much. Thank you very much, everyone, for being here. It's a great pleasure and an honor to have been invited. So I'm going to talk about Kant on revolutions, but I will start with an anecdote. The first time I talked about revolutions was with my mother in 1991 in communist Albania. And she was involved in the dissident movements. Things had begun to change a little bit and were happening around us. And people were talking about the revolution. And this was the first time that everyone was talking about revolution in the present. Before that, we talked about revolutions of the past. So there was the French Revolution, there was the Bolshevik Revolution. Sometimes it looked like even the English might have had a revolution almost. But this time it was different because it was something that was happening around me all the time. And so I asked my mom, well, why is everyone talking about a revolution? And since I couldn't quite connect the past with the present, I said, but what is a revolution? And my mom, she looked at me and she said, oh, it's a mess. And I said, okay, but what is it exactly? I mean, a mess is not specific enough, so can you give me a definition? And then she thought I was serious, and so she said, don't do it. So I'm now going to start with a definition that is a little bit more specific than that, also because there is no danger of doing the revolution here. I'm going to start with offering you how I think about revolutions and how I'm going to talk about revolutions over the course of this lecture, and how I will try and defend an account of revolutions that connects to the Kantian analysis of revolution, which has as its heart an interesting paradox and dilemma. And I will tell you a little bit more about the dilemma and then how I suggest we could resolve it. But the revolution, as I understand the term, is the attempt, sometimes accompanied by violence, to change the structure of legal, social, and political relations. And there are some elements to that definition that are quite important to what I'm going to say in a moment, and I think also to the way in which Kant talks about revolution. Namely, the first one is that it's an attempt, which means that not all revolutions are necessarily successful, and that indeed what's important to my argument is that failed revolutions are also as important as successful revolutions. And the other one, that violence is often, but not always, part of a revolution. And that's because I want to make conceptual space for peaceful revolutions of the kind that, by and large, I experienced in Albania in this transition from communism to capitalism, which was a peaceful, relatively speaking, transition. And it was like that for most of Eastern Europe. But it was a revolution in that it did lead to a fundamental change of legal dispositions. And also because I think it's a mistake to distinguish reforms from revolution based on whether they are violent or not. And here I think Rosa Luxemburg is right when she says we don't think about revolutions or reforms as if we are picking sausages from a counter and thinking, do I want hot sausages or cold sausages? We have to understand that sometimes a revolution is necessary to the beginning of a series of reforms, and sometimes a series of reforms leads to a revolution. So revolution, as Rosa Luxemburg understands it, and I think as Kant also understands it, is the kind of act of political creation of a particular legal order that then gets stabilized with a series of reforms, both of which are essential. The revolution as the act of political creation of that legal order, and the reforms as the successive series of measures that will settle that revolution into being and turn it into part of the kind of legal structure. So the term revolution, as we are reminded by Hannah Arendt, is actually originally started to circulate in the 14th century, not with reference to the political and the social world, but with reference to the scientific world, and indeed with reference to Copernicus' understanding of revolutions, where what was meant by revolution was actually the rotation of planets around the orbit. And in that understanding, revolution has something cyclical about it, and indeed seems quite far from how we intuitively think about revolutions when we think of them as fundamental change of paradigm, because what's essential to this scientific understanding is the circularity and the predictability of the motion of the orbit. And in that sense, this notion of circularity, foreseeability, predictability seems quite different from when we think about revolutions politically as acts of rupture, of fundamental break, and of creating the new from the old. And that's because it seems like revolution in that scientific way of talking brings us closer to nature, and it's about the, somehow the laws of nature and the predictability of the laws of nature. And the revolution in the political sense, it's more about the workings of freedom and our efforts to realize freedom. So it seems like the scientific term, which inspired the political term, is quite different, and there's a discrepancy there in how we think, even though it's the same word. But that discrepancy is actually, if you think about it, settled when you realize how revolutionaries talk and think about revolution, where it's often not about finding something completely new, but returning to a condition of natural freedom or natural justice that has been somehow subverted by the existing institutions. And so it's about, for revolutionaries, it's about the political struggles that will return us to this natural way of thinking about how we should relate to each other, rather than about something that's very new. And so in that sense, that circularity and predictability and foreseeability is just as part of the political concept as it is of the scientific one. And that's because those principles of how we naturally belong together, and those principles of natural freedom or natural justice, revolutionaries think also need their champions. And they need to be defended. If they're missing in the world in which we live, they need to be advocated by some people out there. And that's how revolutionaries think of themselves. They think of themselves as the guardians of these natural principles of being together. And sometimes they do that with a very high cost to themselves. So if you think about the famous Lenin description of the activity of politics, he says, well, politics is not like the pavement of the Nevsky Prospect, the kind of broad, paved, nicely looking street in perfectly straight main street in St. Petersburg. Or if you think about Mao's famous, more famous saying that revolution is not like a dinner party, and it's not as gentle as doing an embroidery or doing a painting or something like that. All of that indicates that the revolutionaries are aware that to defend this natural condition of order and justice, they have, in the meantime, to put up with significant hardship and significant harm, emotional, social, lots of sacrifices, humiliations, and that sometimes the revolutionaries themselves are the first victims of the revolutions that they try to bring about. And again, there is a kind of tragic fate of a lot of revolutionaries that we know about. Think about Robespierre or Trotsky, who are the first victim usually of the principles that they want to bring into being. And actually, revolutions, most of the time, they fail. But sometimes they succeed. And when they succeed, the revolutionaries of the past have to become the rulers of the present. And so if the governments that they create are to be considered legitimate and rule in the name of everyone, they have to actually rule in the name of even the people who argued against and fought against the revolution that they were trying to bring about. So they have to rule not just on behalf of the fellow revolutionaries who wanted to change society, but also of everyone else. So the people who are indifferent to their calls, or to the people who ridiculed them, or the people who first were persuaded and then they changed their mind and so wavered, or the people who actively sought to undermine their projects, or the people who actively fought against them or shot them or tortured them or imprisoned them. So they have to create from this revolution the kind of political institutions that command a much more widespread allegiance and have a much wider basis of legitimacy than the ones that they began with, and from a position where they don't enjoy that legitimacy and that allegiance in the first place. So how does that happen? How is that possible? For all of that to happen, the revolutionaries of the present have to forget that they are revolutionaries. And so they have to forget that they are the ones who actually try to subvert the existing political order in the past. And so extremism, which, as Lenin famously said, is an infantile disorder, is indeed an infantile disorder because it's connected to the infancy of these movements before they become movements that have to be responsible and govern in the name of everyone, and before the revolutionary struggle needs to give way to compromise. So from their point of view, their revolution is the last revolution. There can't be a revolution after that for any revolutionary. So I think this is the reason why revolutions are really ambiguous phenomena, because morality is essential to their genesis, but undermines the legitimacy of the institutions that they produce. And so it's essential that the moral point of view that creates the revolution gives way to the legal point of view that sustains the revolution. And so that means that the means of the revolution are always in tension with their ends, and the genesis of revolution is always in the way of the validity of revolutions. So I think this explains why revolutions are always subject to these two contrasting positions in their assessment and in their evaluation. The people who criticize them on grounds of institutional legalism, and the people who endorse them on grounds of idealistic moralism, basically. So the moralists think that because the ends of the revolution are right, revolution can never be wrong. And the legalists think that because the means of revolution are wrong, revolution can never be right. So I want to now kind of walk you through this dilemma between the legal and the moral when it comes to the assessment of revolutions, and offer an alternative way of thinking about revolutions with Kant that tries to cut across this divide and this ambiguity and tries to resolve this dilemma. And I want to kind of urge you with Kant to think about revolutions with regard not to the justice that it brings to specific people, but based on what Kant did, which was a philosophical theory of history that focuses on how revolutions contribute to collective progress. But before I do that, I want to say a little bit more about this dilemma between the legalist and this fight between the legalist and the moralist. So to explain more what is at stake and why there seems to be this problem when we think about revolutions. So moralists think that if you have certain valid claims that you can defend either as justice or as fundamental interests or as natural condition of what humans belong together and so on, those fundamental moral claims must be prior and trump whatever authority legal institutions have on us. And as I say, you can articulate, you can have different theories for how you get to those claims, but what is common to all of them, to all the moralist defenses of the revolution, is that if morality tells us something about how human beings should relate to each other, then if legal institutions violate those fundamental principles, then there must be a justification for changing things. And so that's the justification for revolution. So when institutions don't reflect these moral commitments, then they should be changed and transformed and overthrown. And surely, the moralists say, surely people have a right to revolution under these circumstances, because they must be able to right the wrongs from which they suffer. So this is the moral stance. The legal stance, the legalist position, says there's a lot of arguments against the revolution. So one of them is prudential arguments. So a lot of revolutions start very well-meaning, but a lot of them end up in carnage. Another argument is one that says, yeah, but why not just try with reform and so have a more progressive approach and rather than a radical upheaval approach. All things equal, you should try and change the laws from within. So even if you like the idea of the revolution in general, you might be skeptical about any specific instance of revolution, because even though it seems good in theory, in practice it always ends up backfiring. And indeed, this also explains why a lot of people who defend revolutions in general, when it comes to specific institutions, specific revolutions, often turn against them. So for people who are fans Orwell's Animal Farm and his analysis of the Bolshevik Revolution in that book. You might remember the very end of the book, a few years after the revolution has already happened, the farm animals witness Napoleon the pig playing cards with Mr. Pickleton, and Orwell closes Animal Farm with this devastating final sentence where he wraps up the revolution of the animals against the humans by saying, and I quote, this last sentence of the book, "The creatures outside looked from pig to man, and from man to pig, and from pig to man again, but already it was impossible to say which was which." So this is where you get at the end of a revolution, you're not quite sure anymore, these revolutionaries, are they defending the old order or the new order, or have they become just like the people that they were trying to fight? And the point that Orwell makes is a familiar one that all of us intellectuals will have experienced at one point or another, where you begin by embracing a revolution, but then you become really dissatisfied and unhappy with the way it turns out, and so you want to kind of distance yourself from it. And so that means that we might, most of us, like the idea of revolutions in general, but end up not liking any revolution particularly in concrete. And end up also concluding that maybe, in the end, this more slow, more evolutionary approach might be more desirable. Now, what is really interesting about Kant is that he thought exactly the opposite, and I'll tell you in a minute why he thought the opposite of Orwell, and the opposite of how most intellectuals think intuitively, because he actually rejected revolutions in general, but was a really big fan of one particular revolution, which was the French Revolution. And that's kind of Kant's puzzle, and that's why he's an interesting author through which to think about the question of revolutions. And apparently, this is anecdotal, but when he, just to give you a sense of how he thought about this one specific revolution, when he received news by one of his students that of the installment by revolutionary force of the Republic in France, he was then 65 years old, and there is a witness student accounts, historical accounts of Kant as having said, "Finally, I can say, like Simon, I quote, 'God, let your servant die in peace, because I've already lived this memorable day.'" And actually, around 1793, which was, as you'll know, exactly the time in which the French Revolution turns into its most oppressive phase, and around the reign of terror, and enters its darkest days, which led most intellectuals who had up to that point supported the revolution, when it went through its Jacobin turns, to say, hang on now, like Orwell, it's just gone too far, let's rethink all this. This is exactly when Kant became most enthusiastic about it. And so, again, one of his students, Nicolovius, reports that Kant insisted, as people were confronting him with, but look at this horror of the Jacobins, how can you still support the French Revolution? Nicolovius says, I quote, that Kant said that all the horrors that took place in France were nothing compared to those that people had suffered under a despotic regime, and that the Jacobins, quote, were probably right in all their actions. Now, Kant was not a consequentialist, so for Kant to say, you know, the horrors of the revolutionaries are way better than the horrors of the previous, there's something strange going on there. And the strangest thing going on is that Kant was, as I say, famous up to that point for insisting that revolutions in general can never be justified. And so this is now another quote from Kant's writing on revolution, where he says, "A people has a duty not to rebel, even against an unjust government." So this whole moralistic stance that I started by introducing, this was not Kant's favorite stance. As he puts it, "A people, quote, has a duty to put up with even what is held to be the most unbearable abuse of supreme authority," end of quote. And Kant's rationale against revolutions in general is the same one that he deploys throughout his political writings, also to reject other things that a lot of people like these days, like humanitarian intervention, for example, or in the case of his time, colonialism and the European civilizing missions in other parts of the world. And the reason he made this argument is that he thought that a group of people can't unilaterally use coercion to change the existing legal structure, however inadequate that legal structure is, because a group of people which recognizes and is recognized by a public system of law, Kantot, is already subjected to a type of collective rule, and that collective rule will be undermined by any unilateral action to replace that existing legal order with an alternative one. And so that applies both to the revolutionaries, to humanitarian intervention, or to these civilizing missions. So for Kant, it was indifferent what aim the people who try to overthrow these governments had. You know, you could have very well-meaning revolutionaries who are trying to fight an oppressive government, authoritarian, despotic government, as he says it. You could have a very well-meaning European government that is trying to bring civilization to a non-European people, in a case of his time. You could have another intervention more familiar to us nowadays, which is you could have a group of very well-meaning foreigners that are trying to bring just rule to another country. Think about the Iraq War or something like that. In all of these cases, Kant would have said, all of these actions are unilateral and undermine the positive body of law that a collective already recognized and has some provisional legitimacy, however flawed it is. So, and that's because Kant thought there is a transition point where all public authority is destroyed by these revolutionaries or by these external interventors, and all the principles of right on which that collective body is grounded are subverted and annihilated. And that means that you have a return from a civilized condition to a state of nature, where by returning to the state of nature, all claims of individuals no longer hold, because you need the law to actually make recognized claims on one another. So revolutionary attempts, Kant thought to, and this is to explain why he was so hostile to revolutions in general, revolutionary attempts to dismantle political authority are contradictory because they undermine the basis from which any claims to right can be made by all subjected people to a particular legal order. And revolutionaries place themselves outside the sphere of publicly recognized rights, and in doing so, act unilaterally, and any unilateral act that is placed outside that public body is, for Kant, intrinsically wrong. So revolutionaries coercively put obligations on others without having any basis that justifies what grounds those obligations. So they're kind of acting unilaterally by just imposing the way they see the polity to everyone else. So this is the position. You have rejection of the revolution in general, and then you have a kind of endorsement of this specific revolution. So how do we understand this? How can we make sense of this? And is there a way of making sense of it? And I think there is a way of making sense of it, but it requires us to move away from an individualistic perspective on revolution that says, is revolution right or wrong from the point of view of those who think about whether we ought to justify revolution or not, and shift to what Kant thinks of as a universal philosophical historical perspective. So you have a way of reconciling the historical desirability of revolutions in general with the ambiguity of particular revolutions by focusing not on individuals in existing political circumstances, but on the rationale for revolution from a more general standpoint, which I will call, for want of a better term, from the point of view of the species being. So what is the species being? The species being is a way of talking about humanity that thinks of humans as going beyond the specific relations that exist between humans at any specific point in time, and that thinks of humanity as a kind of temporally stretched moral relation. And so, how does Kant, what is the standpoint from which, if we think about revolutions from the point of view of the species being and of these temporally stretched moral relations, what is the justification that we can give of specific revolutions of the past without necessarily committing to a defense of revolutions in the future? And in the remainder, 5-10 minutes, I'll go and I'll explain a little bit more. I'll try and unpack this point of view, which Kant says it's very, which is connected in Kant's account to the question of the progress of species more general. So his analysis of the French Revolution and his defense of the French Revolution beyond these anecdotes that I've explained occurs in a series of writings where the central question to those writings is the question of, are human beings making moral progress towards the better? And Kant says, this is a very difficult question to answer, because we can't say anything about human beings since they are free beings. And so anything we say will prescribe a course of events to these beings that are by definition beings to whom we cannot prescribe a course of events. So moral norms tell us what people should do, but even when they know what they should do, they don't necessarily do what they should, because all sorts of things happen in the empirical world in which we also live as not purely guided by moral norms, but also by external circumstances that sometimes conspire against us. And so you have ideology, you have false consciousness, you have brute force, you have fake news, what have you. So there's a lot of things happening in the world that undermine moral imperatives. So to ask whether there is moral progress for Kant means to ask the question of, is there anything, is there any empirical experience that we can point to answer the question of, yes, there might be moral progress in the positive, and what might that experience be? And in the context of that question, the answer that Kant gives is that, yes, there is an experience, and that's the experience of the French Revolution, which he thought of as a sign that humanity was making moral progress towards the better. So why did Kant think that this was, why did Kant think that the revolution is the sign of moral progress? Now, it's really important that he's talking about signs, because a sign is just a sign, it's not a cause. And this is one of the things that gets mistaken about Kant's understanding Kant's philosophy of history and people saying that it's deterministic and so on. Actually, Kant has no claim that progress is causal and irreversible. And he's right about that, because if there was irreversible progress, we wouldn't have had the Holocaust after Kant's accounts of progress, and we wouldn't be on the verge of environmental catastrophe after our discussions on moral progress. So the question of freedom remains central to understanding why is it that we can't talk about progress in this irreversible way. A sign is just a sign. It's an empirically observable phenomenon to which we can point to say there is a possibility proof here that sometimes humans are morally motivated. And for Kant, the French Revolution gave just this perspective. And the question is, well, why did he think that the French Revolution is this sign of moral progress? And here, there's two arguments, which have to do not with the way in which philosophers up to that point, whenever they talked about progress, whether there was progress, they always thought about the actions of the great men. So it was like, you know, the siècle of Louis XIV for Voltaire, or for Montesquieu, it was the analysis of the causes of the rise and fall of the Romans. And so there was always either a civilizational story or a great leader, a great man's story. Kant's story about progress is very different, because it's focusing, even as it analyzes an event, it's actually focusing on the reaction to that event. And so it's focusing on the response of the public to the events of the French Revolution. And as he puts it, the enthusiasm that the French Revolution generates in those who observe that event. Now, and so as he puts it, it's in the mode of thinking of the spectators that show a universal but disinterested sympathy for the action of one group as opposed to another group. So Kant identifies a sign of moral progress in enthusiasm, and it's interesting that it's an enthusiasm of the partiality of impartiality. So it's the enthusiasm of the champions of reason who is being channeled at that point by this particular group of people who asks demands of the public, of the spectators, to take sides with this group rather than this other group. And again, it's very interesting here that this is a partial analysis. Not everyone liked the French Revolution when Kant was writing. And as you know, Burke had a lot of very nasty things to say about it, and indeed about the actions of the French revolutionaries. So Kant thought that the sign of moral progress is in the disinterested sympathy that the French Revolution generates in people who have otherwise no reason to care about the French Revolution, and indeed might even be threatened or felt endangered by endorsing the cause of the French Revolution. And there's two arguments for why he thinks that. The first one has to do with the fact that revolutions, and this is why they are important, and it's important to analyze them from the point of view of this philosophy of history, the first one is that they shift the boundaries of political feasibility. And the second one is that they have an effect that has a kind of aesthetic moral education function. I'm just going to say something very quickly about both of them. So why are revolutions important when it comes to feasibility? Well, because as it happens, the question of feasibility is one of the most important obstacles to thinking about radical political projects in the future and how they get realized. So think about how many times you suggested great things to do in the world, and well, that happens to me all the time, and people say, that sounds really great in theory, but is it actually going to work in practice? And since we're in election mode, there's elections in the UK, when Keir Starmer, the new prime minister, incoming, I think, prime minister in the UK, hopefully, was accused last year of breaking several campaign pledges, he said, I have to be realistic about what is possible. In other words, I have to lie because it's a really tough world out there. And so he was quoting a feasibility constraint on moral desiderata, basically. So now the problem is that what is and isn't possible is itself subject to political interpretation. And actually there are no hard facts about social possibility in the world. All facts, all social facts are facts that come out of an interpretation of other social facts. So our assessment of what is and isn't realistic usually depends on how we balance priorities, how we rank the facts, how we assess the chances, likelihood of success. And there's a lot of elements that contribute to making a proposal unrealistic. So people, you know, you might say, I do it, I do the right thing, but other people don't because they're self-centered, I'm motivated, but they're not. Or you might think, you know, people are afraid to speak up, so this is a very brave decision that you need to make here to stand up for someone. It's not in your immediate self-interest, so why would you take the cost? Or because other people just can't see it because they're manipulated by propaganda, they're doing it because they want to get more likes on Facebook than actually get to the truth. And all these other constraints, these are all social constraints on our assessment of feasibility. And all of this was true in the time in which Kant lived, just as it is in ours. And what Kant was arguing with the defense of the sign of the French Revolution, really, was that the presence of revolutionary enthusiasm, the type of attitude that the observing of revolution generates, shows that sometimes we can go beyond these hard constraints, or what we think of as hard constraints on our lives. So enthusiasm is the kind of visible sign of identification with the cause of revolutionaries who is advanced in the name of reason and in the name of the whole humanity, and where we understand that progress then is not a question of abstract belief in the future, but is actually feasible and possible. Someone does it, goes out there and changes the picture somehow, breaks the hard mental barriers that we have in thinking about what is and isn't possible. So this is a kind of conception of history that's the opposite of how, again, people think about Kant's philosophy of history, where they say, well, it's deterministic and it's teleological, understanding teleology as something deterministic. Because actually, what revolutions do, instead of reifying nature, they demystify it. They make it clear that there was really no hard constraint there. This was just your way of thinking. This was just was in your mind and in your assessment of the world rather than really out there. And so the revolutionary enthusiasm is the moral feeling that we experience when we understand that the world is not as settled as it looks, and that however much we think that we are or other people are ideologically manipulated or controlled by alien forces or shaped by other agents, actually it's possible to change. And that's just as much as he wanted to say with his idea of revolutions as changing the boundaries of political feasibility. And so Kant thinks that the French Revolution is valuable because it culminates in the achievement of a formal condition of right that was up to that point thought impossible because of the church, because of the ancien regime, and so on. And now, of course, a lot of people think, well, that wasn't the case, that Kant was too optimistic, that the French Revolution was not the culmination of this realm of freedom of justice that Kant made it sound. But I think this just shows that the project of the Enlightenment that he was starting with is incomplete rather than that it's flawed. And so it seems to me that the criticism that there is this way of thinking about the project of the French Revolution or European Enlightenment is, and that it is flawed, is a criticism that needs to be separated from the ideological appropriations of that project and from the other critiques of colonialism and imperialism and capitalism that came after. So with that in mind, I think it's easy to be somehow sympathetic to Kant's argument for revolutions as the types of events that shape and change the boundaries of feasibility, even if we're skeptical about whether those kinds of revolutions actually completed the project that they set out to complete, which was this project of bringing universal justice. Final point, the second argument that Kant gives for revolutions is more about the aesthetic effects that revolutions have. So this was about the political effects. It's achievement of a formal condition of justice that shows us that politically we can do certain things. There's another argument, which is really about the type of feeling that enthusiasm is. And enthusiasm, Kant says, is a symbol of a sublime state of mind. And the sublime is that which enables agents to strengthen their resolution, to follow the dictates of reason, and to somehow contain their senses. And the sublime and the enthusiasm, that is the feeling with which the sublime is revealed, is basically the power of ideas, and of moral ideas in particular, entrenched and represented from a symbolic perspective. So what Kant is saying, that the French Revolution and the mode of thinking that is triggered by certain revolutionary events gives sensible representation and leaves an aesthetic legacy on the sensible representation of these ideas, and where the historical experience of these past revolutions leaves a kind of legacy on how we think about the challenges of the future. So Kant thought that the historical experience in times of crisis, when, you know, the old world is dying and a new world has not emerged again, we draw strength from our reflection aesthetically and the legacy of the previous revolutions, of the previous generations of revolutionaries, and we kind of absorb those efforts as they reflect in cultural experiences, in films or in literature or in art or in however, and in the kind of belief systems they generate, and therefore leave these lasting traces in culture of which the enthusiasm that with which we experience them is an important part. So this is an argument that's completely separate from the question of what does revolutions achieve politically, because it's more about what legacy do revolutions have culturally, and how do we get strength from being part of those cultural experiences when we think about our own predicament and the future. And we learn, in a way, not just from the success then of revolutions, but also the failed revolutions are experiences from which we draw strength. And Marx, in the Paris Commune Reflections, has something similar along those lines when he talks about the previous generation's efforts weighing on the brains of the current generations. Now, you might ask, why does this not apply to other collective events? So what is it about revolutions? You might say, well, don't wars also leave a trace in culture, in cinema and tragedies and literature and arts and so on? So surely, as people say, war has the same capacity to move us and as I say, leave these traces. So why is it that war doesn't make us enthusiastic? Only revolutions make us enthusiastic, for Kant. And I think the answer is that for Kant, and again, I think he's right, wars make us give up on humanity. Revolutions affirm our humanity affirming, whereas wars are humanity undermining. And so there is actually no enthusiasm for war, because at most you have the celebration of heroism. Whereas with revolutions, what you're celebrating is the humanity that people are trying to establish as they assert themselves and as they fight with the kind of old order. So with revolutions, you kind of look back to previous experiences and you find evidence in the power of these moral ideas, in the feelings of enthusiasm that come out of these transformative political events. And revolutionary events then play this educative, this kind of aesthetic educative function, in addition to this morally, to this politically emancipatory function, because it's an argument where the memory of revolution and the memory also of failed revolutions plays just as an important role as the success of revolutions that we know for these feasibility reasons. So I'm just going to wrap up now. I basically started by saying that these authors who examine the justification of revolutions from a normative perspective are divided between the people who hate them for legal reasons and the people who love them for moral reasons. And my perspective was trying to cut across with Kant this divide and to focus not on the actions and the aims of revolutionaries themselves, but on the legacy of revolutions as events in general, by saying that on the one hand, revolutions transform the conceptual categories available to us when we assess the feasibility of radical transformative action, and across space and across time, they contribute to this morally educative role that develops the kind of learning process from which future generations benefit. So I don't want you to leave thinking, okay, are revolutions justified or not in the end? And to which I want to say with Kant, that is the wrong question. Is a revolution justified or not? This is the wrong question, because actually nobody has ever asked an intellectual, can I please have a revolution or not? They just happen. They are facts, and they happen for all sorts of reasons, often irreducible to moral planning, in a way. And they've always happened, and they will presumably continue to happen. Their nature might change. They might become less violent. They might become the forms through which they occur will be dependent on technology and scientific development and cultural development more broadly. But it is quite likely that history is made of revolutions, because even in nature you have revolutions. Actually, there's these radical breaks. There are leaps also in nature. And so it's likely that there will be leaps in history as well. The question is not to recover and to be able to answer this puzzle, or are revolutions justified or not? But what I think going back to a Kantian perspective on revolutions does is to help us recover the ability to reflect on the contribution that they make to this question of moral progress, which is still going to be relevant, and on how the principles that any particular revolution promotes contribute to the development of humanity as a whole. So, as I say, these days people think that to talk about the interests of humanity is to justify colonialism or imperial domination, but actually I don't think that either colonialism or imperialism or capitalism ever had the interests of humanity in sight when they were operating, and they failed not because they were universal, but because they weren't universal enough. So the point is to kind of understand, while the causes of political change are always bound up with specific empirical processes, we need to be able to look at the past in a way that enables us to learn from the past, and Kant gives us the tools through which we can think about that past in light of a philosophically reconstructed analysis of history that is centered on revolutions as these visible signs of moral progress as a species. And I think he had a point with asking us to take that approach. So that's it. Thank you.
Ist das Mikrofon an oder muss ich es anschalten? Es ist an. Wunderbar. Ja, vielen Dank für den schönen Vortrag. Ich hatte den Vorteil, dass ich ihn schon so ein bisschen kannte und mich vorbereiten konnte. Stichwort Revolution. Ihre Mutter sagte auf die Frage, was ist eine Revolution, auf die kindliche Frage, don't do it, it's a mess. Da Sie ein sehr persönliches Buch, dieses Freibuch geschrieben haben, ist vor ein paar Jahren im Surkamp Verlag erschienen, war monatelang auf der Bestsellerliste, wirklich ein ganz tolles Memoir über Ihre persönlichen Erfahrungen im Transformationsprozess eben im Albanien der 90er Jahre. Welches Szenario genau hatte wohl Ihre Mutter vor Augen, als sie Ihnen sagte, don't do it, it's a mess?
I think it was more, it's okay, wenn ich auf Englisch antworte, oder?
Ich denke schon, ja. Obwohl, ich hab eine Arte-Sendung mit Ihnen im Vorfeld gesehen und da sagen Sie, Sie haben Deutsch mit Kant, Hegel und Marx gelernt. Also ich glaube, dass wir das schon wagen könnten, aber ich verstehe natürlich
aber
auch,
nee,
dass
nicht nach zwei Bieren, okay. So, I think what she had in mind was the fear of the radical transformation. And just when I was asking her this question, actually the revolution was not finished yet. And this is another really important thing, I think, to understand about revolutions, is that you can only say something meaningful about them when they're over. But when you're in the middle, you don't actually know what it is that you're talking about. So when she said it's a mess, I don't think she meant just the fear and the cost and the burden, the emotional burden of having to transition and thinking that you're in this transition. It's more that you don't actually know when it's finished and when you're still in the middle or when you're and or whether it will fail. And we can only we speak of revolutions only when we know that they're complete. But this is, I think, also something that's behind Kant's caution against revolutionaries to begin with, before revolutions happen. This is why we can only say something meaningful about revolutions that have already happened, because she thought, and I think she was right to think that, that before the revolution is successful, it could be just a bunch of fools trying to change something and fail, and at very high cost.
Und die Kosten für ihre Familie, die waren ja auch in der Tat sehr hoch erstmal. Also yeah. Sie kommen aus einer Dissidentenfamilie, die im Sozialismus gelitten hat, mit Inhaftierungen, der Vater war inhaftiert, mit allen Arten von Repressalien. Und nach dem, im Transformationsprozess, es bricht dann auch Bürgerkrieg aus und es gibt irgendwie eine riesige Finanzkrise dann in Albanien. Ihre Familie ist auch davon betroffen. Vielleicht erzählen Sie das nochmal.
Yeah, I think so. What was also really interesting and why in some ways the past experience and the way in which the past shapes us was really important in this case as well, is that my family had tried to change things in Albania when communism just came to power. And so my grandfather was a social democrat and he was trying to create and be part of this left-wing movement that would take Albania in a different direction from the Stalinism that ended up prevailing, and he went to prison in the first purge against the left, so the 1946. After that, there were lots of different purges in Albania, but they were all within the party. So all the opposition to the Stalinist, to the Communist Party, that was from the outside of the boundaries of Stalinism, that was all taken care of in 1946. And that generation and people who came out of those families all thought that this was a disaster, which is why in 1990, my mother was an exception in being at the forefront of the dissidents, because the dissident movement was not led by the families that had been dissident in 1940. It was actually, most of the dissidents were dissidents from within the Communist Party, because these were the dissidents that hadn't tried to be dissident already. They were all people who were loyalists most of the time, and they were the ones that could have the courage to change things. Otherwise, the other ones who had already had the experience of imprisonment and so on, they had already tried it, and so they had learned that it was no point trying. And this is also something that's really important, I think, about the transition in Eastern Europe and these experiences of revolutionaries. When do people become revolutionaries? Often revolutionaries come out of the ranks of those who defend the status quo, because the real revolutionaries, they're not even visible. You don't know where they are, because they've already been taken care of in some previous wave of history before that. And I think this is what also was driving the skepticism from that stance.
Und ihre Familie hat dann im Transformationsprozess auch sehr viel verloren. Also alles, was nicht vorher schon verloren war, war dann verloren. Können Sie das noch mal ein bisschen erzählen?
Yeah, so this was in this was as part of the process of opening up to free market economy in Albania in 97, and which came with the opening of these pyramid schemes where people would put a lot of money and save and then lost everything after that. So this was another, that was not a revolution, because it's not like there was a kind of system. I think to have a revolution, you have an idea of what kind of alternative system legally you want to put in place. This was an instance of revolt where you see a complete collapse of the old order, but you don't see a new attempt to kind of, you have insurrection, but you don't have revolution, because you have no effort to replace that condition with something different. It's just anarchy, basically. So 97 was, in my mind, like a revolution, because it was the sort of thing where you understand that there is a deep crisis and where things are not coming together and everything collapses. And so the circumstances were revolutionary, but there was no revolution because there was no agent that was actually trying to change anything and to take it in any progressive direction. And in those years, my father was actually, he was director of the port of Duros. He had been in charge of leading the neoliberal reforms and the structural reforms and the shock therapy that came to Albania as part of the transition. And he was in charge of actually, in some ways, forcing these new laws and new rules of the new system on the new people, even though he had been on the side of the losers before, he was now on the side of those who were actually imposing these reforms on others.
In Deutschland gab es 1989 ja die sogenannte Friedliche Revolution, in Tschechien die Samtene Revolution, also Velvet Revolution. Ist es nicht, nach allem, was wir jetzt auch in dem Vortrag gehört haben, ein Widerspruch in sich, eine gewaltlose, eine geordnete Revolution sozusagen, obwohl Sie ja auch gesagt haben, man sollte Reform nicht unbedingt von Revolution unterscheiden?
Yeah,
aber diese Begriffe, die sind ja irgendwie eigentlich irreführend oder verniedlichend.
Yeah, I think so, because I think, but I, so I think in some ways this goes to the point that I don't think we understand the difference between reform and revolution by thinking about the method, by thinking whether it's violent or not violent, because I think reforms can also be very violent on people. So the structural reforms that I was explaining that my father was in charge of when he was leading the port of Duros and had to, for the sake of privatization of the port, sack a lot of people. These were reforms, but the violence on people's lives was really significant. And it's not clear that if they had undergone through a revolution, they would have experienced more violence. You know, when you're left without a job or when you're left without sustenance or where you can't access healthcare for your children or when you don't have money to buy medicine for your children, this is very violent. And this is the result of reforms, and they were called reforms, they were called structural reforms. The legal basis of it was the revolution, the peaceful revolution that happened in 1989-1990. The juridical structure of society changed fundamentally. And then, as Rosa Luxemburg says, you then need this juridical system to settle through a series of reforms, of which the neoliberal reforms of the 90s across the Balkans and Eastern Europe were an example. And these were very violent reforms. So it's not so the revolution as such was peaceful, but the reforms were violent. And this also goes to explain the point that you have a revolution which then requires reforms to be settled, or likewise, you have a series of reforms for a very long time, and then you have a revolution that will bring into being another juridical order. And I think this point is really important when we think, because that's the only thing that I think distinguishes reforms from revolution is how it affects the fundamental juridical structure of the state or of the constellation of states or of the world.
Vielleicht muss man auch nach dem Begriff der Gewalt fragen in dem Zusammenhang. Also kurioserweise haben wir in Deutschland diese Diskussion über die Wende und was sie sozusagen an Zumutungen für die Menschen mit sich gebracht hat, eigentlich erst jetzt, in den letzten Jahren, seit der Corona-Krise ist es dann besonders aufgekommen mit diesen ganzen Pegida-Demonstrationen, mit den Querdenker-Demonstrationen, jetzt mit den Wahlergebnissen, die so Ost und West wirklich nochmal so also politisch auch total spalten. Und dass man jetzt eigentlich erst in der Lage ist, darüber zu reflektieren, wie schmerzhaft die biografischen Brüche eben in vielen Ostfamilien doch waren oder empfunden wurden von den Eltern, aber vor allen Dingen dann eben auch von den Nachgeborenen, von deren Kindern, die eben mit diesen Eltern in der Dauerkrise oder in dieser Abwertungsspirale irgendwie auch zurechtkommen mussten. Wir haben diese Diskussion eben jetzt erst mit einer ganz, ganz großen Verspätung von mehreren Jahrzehnten.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, especially in the case of Germany with East Germany and West Germany, I feel the problem here is that there has been a kind of violence of peace that people haven't talked about. So the Cold War ended. And it was like a war. It ended. I mean, it was a cold war because it was cold. There was no real war. But it was a war in that there were winners and losers. And like in every war, the winners decided the terms on which the losers would create the new society that emerged from the loss. And I think this happened to Eastern Europe vis-a-vis Western Europe. And in Germany, it happened to East Germany vis-a-vis West Germany. This, the terms of the peace were the terms of the winners. And the winners were the West Germans. The West Germans decided the juridical structure that the East Germans were to have and the kinds of institutions that they would have to have live with were not their institutions. They were institutions that came as the result of a conflict that ended like a war. And so I think in Eastern Europe it's the same. It's only now that we see this reaction, just like you had in the interwar period after the First World War, punitive terms for the end of war that then leads to this long-term resentment that brews and brews and brings these grievances and creates this nationalistic or particularistic identity-based resentment that then creates the conditions for an even bigger conflict to emerge. I think right now it's quite similar how we experience something like the result of these years of resentment in which you had a war that ended with the imposition of certain terms on the losers. And where the losers begin to then think, okay, what where's my dignity and under what conditions did I have to accept all these things and how was I, you know, why did my job end like this and why did I have to suddenly, I was a doctor and I was a teacher and I had to become a cleaner for some family in the case of Albania, in the West, in I'm sure in Eastern Germany, there was also within Germany exodus and emigration. So all of these effects of the transition, or if you want us to be more abrupt about it, of the war, are all costs that sink and then eventually lead to resentment and then breed social conflicts that emerge in the forms that we are now seeing them emerge.
Also jedenfalls müssen wir sicherlich den Begriff der friedlichen oder der samtenen Revolution irgendwie nochmal neu bedenken, evaluieren. Sie haben vor zwei Wochen, das habe ich vorhin in der Ankündigung schon gesagt, die sogenannten Benjamin Lectures gehalten. Es ist eine philosophische Vorlesungsreihe angesiedelt an der HU, in der die Kernfragen der Gegenwart von Philosophen und Philosophinnen bearbeitet werden. Und da haben Sie sehr eindrücklich für eine Neubewertung des Sozialismus geworben. Jetzt, bevor wir gleich ein bisschen genauer darüber sprechen, habe ich mich gefragt, ich habe es vorhin schon gesagt, Sie kommen aus einer Dissidentenfamilie, Ihre Familie erlebte alle Arten von Repressalien. Wie kann man mit Ihrer Lebensgeschichte jetzt einfach auch wieder mal biografisch gefragt überhaupt den Begriff des Sozialismus, also die Ideengeschichte des Sozialismus nochmal positiv neu bewerten?
Yeah, because I think maybe the first thing to say that's really important is that the victims of socialist, of state socialism or of Stalinism weren't just capitalists. The victims of Stalinists were also socialists, like my grandfather. He was a social democrat, not a social democrat that you would now think of as a social democrat, but of the old social democrats who actually thought that there was something to this conflict between democracy and capitalism, and where he thought that these two things are not really compatible, and so you can have more democracy only by having less capitalism, whereas now everyone seems to think that democracy and capitalism go along very happily together. And so that was old social democracy.
Sie hat mit Olaf Scholz gerade gesprochen, muss ich vielleicht hier noch einschieben. Und er hat gesagt, dass er aus Ihrem Buch nichts gelernt habe. Aber das nur by the way.
Well, I mean, I was trying to actually, I'm simply trying to make the case that if you call yourself social democrat, it's actually, there is a value to social democracy. But, you know, either you want to have the term or and the term means something to you, or it's not clear why people are even using the label when they don't actually want social democracy. It's clear that they want something else. So this is for me the starting point with this project on moral socialism or, you know, radical social democracy. It can just be traditional social democracy in a way, because it's not more than the point that democracy and socialism are not compatible, and capitalism are not compatible. And so we need to build towards a radical democratic society that means a less capitalistic society. But my starting point is that why should state socialism appropriate the label of socialism? And then as a result of that appropriation, we end up exonerating capitalism for everything bad that it also provokes, just because we think that all the victims of socialism must necessarily be people who want capitalism. I mean, it seems to me that this is both a problem philosophically, but it's also a problem historically, because these dissident movements in Eastern Europe in 1989, they weren't free market movements. They weren't capitalist, pro-capitalist movements. They were pro-democracy movements. They were movements, if you read the writings of Havel, for example, Czech dissident, then politician, the first thing that you understand is that this was for a genuine third alternative. So just like there was a demand for an alternative in the West, there wasn't a demand for an alternative in the East. The alternative to the East was not the West automatically. It could have been something else for both the East and the West. And so it's really important to me to recover this question that must be shared by both the East and the West, given that the conditions of injustice are shared. That is a question of what is a new system that is better for both this former communist world and this current capitalist world, both of which have failed for different reasons. And we can't concede to the historical argument that says all the victims of state socialism were the people who wanted capitalism. That's just false philosophically, but it's also false historically, I think.
Das Zauberwort, mit dem Sie arbeiten, ist moralischer Sozialismus. Und an der Stelle bringen Sie Kant ins Spiel. Vielleicht erklären Sie uns kurz, wie Kant uns sozusagen helfen kann, den Sozialismus zu retten, und zwar mit Hilfe der Moral.
Yeah. So it start I call it moral socialism because I started thinking about this when I was presenting the Benjamin lectures. I was reading around, and one of the things that is really striking is in the history of the state socialist movement, you have this article by Trotsky that says that the title is Their Moral and Ours. And the argument is that there is a bourgeois morality and then there is a socialist morality, and there are the laws of history that decide who is right and who is wrong. And that is a very anti-Kantian, but also anti-philosophical argument that ends up delivering, replacing one dogmatism for another dogmatism, because it's a kind of argument that says that morality is a group-specific morality. And it seems to me that morality is universal, and the conditions under which we seek to realize moral principles are contingent and historical and need to take into account of these learning processes that I was just describing with Kant. But the project is one and is universal. So for me, it's really important when I talk about moral socialism to recover this Kantian core, which is that reason is universal and reason thinks in universal structures and engages with the world from this point of view of a universal question. And it seems to me that any, again, attempt to move away from that will deliver us to these conflicts of identities and groups and particularizations and fragmentations of conflict, none of which are able to actually resolve the kinds of crises that we face, which are global crises and which affect the humans as human, not as members of any particular group or any particular country or any particular state.
Also es gilt sozusagen, den Universalismus in dem sittlichen Moralentwurf von Kant irgendwie stark zu machen für die Idee des Sozialismus. Es gibt aber noch einen zweiten Begriff in dieser Wortschöpfung des moralischen Sozialismus, die auch Fragen aufwirft oder problematisch ist. Es ist eben die Moral, und mir ist irgendwie so bei der Vorbereitung nochmal so durch den Kopf gegangen, Moral ist im Verlauf des 21. Jahrhunderts vor allem ja zur Kampfformel irgendwie so ein bisschen verkommen. Für alle möglichen Gruppierungen, die sich gegenseitig immer amoralisches Verhalten vorwerfen. Aber eigentlich wird Moral immer nur so als Kampfbegriff benutzt, um den Gegner schlecht dastehen zu lassen oder zu denunzieren. Also Moral sozusagen im kantischen Sinne als Vernunftsgebrauch, als Mittel sozusagen, als universalistische sittliches Gesetz, das dann sozusagen zu einer allgemeinen Freiheit und Gerechtigkeit führt, ist so ein bisschen out, habe ich den Eindruck. Insofern problematisch, dass Sie diesen Begriff benutzen, auch wenn ich natürlich verstehe, wie Sie ihn benutzen wollen, aber vielleicht können Sie da auch noch mal ein bisschen was zu sagen, ob Sie darüber auch nachgedacht haben.
Yeah, because I don't think you can get out of morality. And so, and you can't, just like you can't, for Kant, morality is what is essential about humans, and it's essential about humans as reasoning species. And so the opposite of morality is to is actually animal life. And so the kind of Darwinistic, the war of all against all, or the stronger people call the shots and make the rules. It seems to me that when Kant thinks and writes about morality being universal and morality being at the heart of this radical political project, which is ultimately the Enlightenment project, what that project tells us is simply that we need to go back to exercising critical thinking again and engage with all social structures from the smaller to the largest by recovering our capacity to think critically, because we are the kinds of species that can think critically and therefore can see through ideology, propaganda, manipulation, fake news, particularism, and so on. So it seems to me that to go back to, if we want to recover this kind of radical criticism, which is, to my mind, the core of this Enlightenment as a call, because as I said earlier, the Enlightenment is not finished. It's actually, the problem with the Enlightenment is that there is not enough Enlightenment, not that the Enlightenment was problematic. It's just that there was no Enlightenment. And we're still trying to find out what the Enlightenment is and how we can be more enlightened. So if we take that call seriously as a critical call, that is not the call of authority. That's the call of not even the moral authority. So not even the authority of the moralizer, not even the philosopher, which is why it's really interesting. Kant says at some point when he says, where are the philosophers? He says, who is a philosopher? He says, well, there are no philosophers. Philosophy is an activity. And so critical thinking is a kind of thinking that needs to be recovered and that we need to politically work in order to recover, so that people can engage with the structures in which they live and see through the way they are being manipulated by power. And it's a kind of, well, I think we live in really authoritarian societies, not just authoritarian in terms of how they exercise the law, but authoritarianism of the mind.
The discourse is auch autoritär.
So we live in an age of endorsement of authority. Mm-hmm. Whether it's the authority of discourse, whether it's the authority of common sense, whether it's the authority of exactly saying, well, this is not really feasible, and you know, you have all these ideas about socialism, but you know, have you thought about how bad people are? And so these are all forms of shaping of the mind that try to paralyze critical thinking, basically. So what Kant does is to give you a basis for recovering this very elementary thing that we all have, which we occasionally have historically also deployed and occasionally also successfully, to just recover that as the basis of fundamental criticism of society in hope that that will generate a new democratic re-energizing of our societies. And what my addition to that, this was not Kant now, this is my addition, I don't think that is possible under a social economic system that makes it very difficult for people to actually reason genuinely, because everything in that system is geared towards not making us think. And again, it's very obvious, you go outside and you're constantly exposed to advertising, or you're constantly exposed to social media pressure, or you're constantly exposed to media spinning. With the politicians, you're constantly exposed to narratives about, you know, why is this politician delegitimized and this politician is legitimized. And all of these are forms of authority that we accept and take for granted, all of which I think are somehow structured by the types of societies that we live in.
Also wenn man jetzt Sozialismus und Moral tatsächlich zusammendenkt, wie Sie das tun, dann macht es ja nur Sinn, wenn am Ende irgendeine Freiheit dabei herauskommt. Und wie müsste diese Freiheit sich jetzt von der eben von Ihnen beschriebenen Freiheit im Kapitalismus oder in dem Stadium des Kapitalismus, im Spätkapitalismus, den wir gerade erleben und der uns, glaube ich, allen gerade ein bisschen unheimlich wird. Wie müsste dieser Begriff von Freiheit aussehen oder wie müsste diese Freiheit aussehen?
Yeah. So, okay. So this is the point usually in my talks where, I don't know if people, it was only people who are from Britain have seen this film called The Life of Brian, mm-hmm. where there is a person that runs around and says, I'm not the Messiah, I'm not the Messiah. And then his mom comes up and says, he's not the Messiah, he's just a naughty boy. So when people ask me this question that you have just asked, I say, I'm just a naughty girl. I'm not the Messiah. But also, because the serious point behind that is that I don't think there is, and this is actually the core of the message, there isn't a philosophy or a philosopher or an author or a body of thought or a manifesto that can have the answer to what is freedom. Freedom is a search, it's an activity, and it's the kind of thing that you find in the process of making yourself free more and more, and that process requires the kind of critical thinking and the liberation from authority and the effort, both moral, personal, but also political, collective, to find freedom. But it's not something that freedom can give. Freedom, you can't create a free society in this Kantian sense. Mm-hmm. To be free is to will the structures that enable freedom to hold for everyone. And that has to be for everyone. Everything short of that is just another form of authoritarianism. It's the authoritarianism of the party in state socialism, of the philosopher, if we think the philosophers have the answer, of the technocrats, of the managers. It's an activity. And so freedom is just the result of the exercise of this critical thinking, which creates and opens the structures within everyone's spaces, personal, political, professional, through which they try to kind of shake off authoritarianism. But it's nothing that, I don't think, there isn't a kind of picture at the end that you say, well, this is what the right society looks like, this is what the free society looks like, because that society would by definition not be free. And that's also partly something that I say in my book, In Free, which is why it's called free ironically, because no one can actually make anyone free. So.
Was mich persönlich im Moment umtreibt, weil einfach sehr viele meiner Freunde und Bekannten irgendwie das gerade so zum Thema haben, das bewegt die Leute sehr. Es ist was sehr Berlinerisches, denn ich glaube, Berlin war eben in der Zeit nach der Wende und dann auch noch in den Nullerjahren, im Grunde noch bis vor 10 Jahren, ja ein bisschen so ein Ort, an dem man so eine Art Kapitalismus-Light leben konnte. Es war immer genug Platz da. Es war nicht sonderlich schwer, eine Wohnung zu finden. Es war nicht sonderlich schwer, Räume für was auch immer zu finden und diese Räume dann eben auch mit Leben zu füllen. Also diese, Sie haben es gerade selbst gesagt, also Enlightenment is a research. Ja? Also man konnte hier researchen in dieser Stadt. Und hat aber trotzdem natürlich im Kapitalismus gelebt und auch die ganzen guten Seiten irgendwie von denen profitieren können. Und jetzt entwickelt sich natürlich Berlin wie alle anderen westlichen Metropolen eben auch in eine sehr, sehr teure, unerschwingliche Stadt, in der bestimmte Lebensläufe nicht mehr so leicht realisierbar sind, die vielleicht in gewisser Weise sich als antikapitalistisch, antikonsumistisch oder einfach eben nicht so als die Speerspitze derjenigen, die sich jetzt diese Wahnsinnsmieten oder so leisten können, leben konnte. Das wird jetzt immer schwerer in dieser Stadt und sehr viele Menschen meiner Generation merken gerade so, dass ihnen so die Felle wegschwimmen, dass ihnen diese Zeit und dieses Lebensgefühl abhanden kommt. Und ich glaube, das ist ein ganz gutes Beispiel, wie Berlin eine Stadt ist, die in so einem Schluck auf der Geschichte hat man sich einfach mal so 20 Jahre total gemütlich gemacht und jetzt platzt natürlich die Blase und jetzt wird es wie überall auch. Ne? Und jetzt merkt man erst, dass man mit einem gewissen nostalgischen Blick jetzt auf die Zeit zurückblickt, nicht nur, weil man da sehr jung war, sondern auch, weil es war eine historische Chance, ja.
Yeah, but I also wonder whether this is the case for everyone, even in Berlin. I'm sure there are, if you're a migrant born to a poor working class family and who has had to struggle throughout the 90s, this is not going to be true. So I think this is the other insight. And of course, you know, if you're from the Balkans, this the paradise that you describe in Berlin, this was not life in the 90s in a lot of Europe. And indeed, I think some of the reactions that we see now are exactly the manifestation of the fact that this wasn't like this. We have, I think there is a certain tendency from some middle-class elites in Western Europe who had a relatively good time in the 90s, who thought that this is now a model that is actually working for everyone. But even as they were saying these things, there were a lot of costs that were being paid by other people, sometimes even within their own cities, but certainly within Europe, for sure, if you extend a little bit the core of Europe, and or indeed get out of the kind of the feeling being relatively comfortable in the capitals. And I think that's in some ways also what's really important about Kant, is that he urges us to think about the effects of injustice in other parts of the world beyond what we experience directly. So it's a kind of theory. I mean, there's two ways you can think about injustice. You can think, well, I only get moved if it affects me. So this is the old materialist, historical Marxist analysis. At some point, all of us will be proletarian. And so this is the story of the changes in Berlin, is at some point, even people who had housing and who had job security become victims of these processes. And so they then experience firsthand this discomfort. So that's the more materialist story. But then you also have a more Kantian story, which says you don't need to materially experience it yourself to understand with reflection that this process is not sustainable for the whole world. That just as these core countries develop and advance, someone else is paying the cost. That the cost of our technological developments, of our goods, of our luxuries, has been the exploitation of people in other parts of the world, or the brain drain, or the migration, or the wars that they suffer, which are all connected, but of which some people gain and other people lose. And unless you expand the parameters for thinking in this Kantian way that says you can be sympathetic to the plight of others even if you're not yourself suffering from that plight, that kind of enlarged perspective is exactly what's, I think, makes you more critical and understand and recover a criticism of society, even if you're not someone who's actually experiencing that injustice.
Ja, meine Damen und Herren, es zuckt schon so ein bisschen da hinten. Sie ist nicht der Messias, aber sie hat große, wichtige Ideen, die sie heute Abend netterweise hier für uns alle entfaltet hat. Vielen Dank fürs Zuhören und vielen Dank, Lea, für das sehr anregende und lebendige Gespräch.
Danke.